I'm gentlemen. I want to help protect your marriages. I help you not sleep on the couch. But a week from this Sunday is Mother's Day. Just so you don't forget and get surprised. I hope you still have your Bibles open to Mark 8:38. And Mark 9:1. Many of you know that the Bible was written by the original authors. There was no punctuation, and there were no chapter breaks. It's unfortunate because Mark 9:1 really should be Mark 8:39. It's a continuous thought that Jesus is sharing. He's talking about his second coming, and he's talking about an event that will take place, a glorious event of his appearing. And that there will be some who will see that event before they die. And so today we're going to spend time in the Transfiguration understanding what Jesus is trying to say. Have you ever worked all day, maybe at your job, or doing housework, or in the garden, to the point where you were exhausted and then you knew you had a night meeting to go to? Well, that's Mark chapter 9. Because the disciples had been with Jesus, and Jesus had been teaching all day, they had been interacting with people all day. And then Jesus said to Peter, James, and John, I want you to go up to a mountain with me. And they were tired. And they knew what to expect. They knew that Jesus oftentimes went up into the mountains and spent hours in prayer. Now, I don't know really why they were so concerned about the fatigue issue, because you know what they were going to do? Pardon? They were going to sleep. They were good at that. They didn't ask Jesus why. I don't know if they were hesitant or if they were concerned about the answer, but they didn't ask him why they were going up there. They knew he was going up there to spend time in prayer. And in their culture, you go up into the mountain for special revelation. And Peter, James, and John got a revelation that they would never forget. Their lives would be changed forever. They were about to experience a mountaintop experience that was beyond what words could describe. Have you ever had a mountaintop experience? Have you ever gone somewhere where you saw glimpses of heaven? Karen and I went to the Bouchard Gardens in British Columbia. Beautiful, acres and acres of manicured gardens. Absolutely gorgeous. No words can describe if you've never seen it yourself. I was in the Philippines holding a series of meetings, and on our one day off, we went to the ocean and snorkeled, and we saw fish and coral and crystal clear water. It was a glorious underwater picture of what heaven must be like. We all need spiritual retreats. We need to be free from our texting, from our emails, from our Facebooks, from our cell phones. We need times that we're alone with God. For as long as He needs us, we're there with Him. We need to go to that higher ground and allow God to speak to us. It's okay to slow down and spend time with God, because our lives are changed when we do that. He never disappoints us. And as believers, we can be as close to Jesus as we're willing. James said in chapter 4, verse 8, draw near to God. Draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. That's a promise. If you seek God, He'll be there. real question is, are you willing to listen? Are you willing to spend time with him? Now, in Mark 9, the Bible says that Jesus was transfigured. That means that for a few moments, the disciples got to see on the outside what Jesus was like on the inside.
So,
that's a punctuation. We know that Jesus came to this world born of a man, born as a man. He wore the peasant clothing of Galileans. He worked as a carpenter. Isaiah 53:2 says that they saw him and there was no beauty that they should desire him. In other words, he appeared to people as an ordinary man. If Jesus was no ordinary man. And when Jesus began the ascent onto this mountain, he was reaching the climax of his ministry. The next few months would be a torturous time for him, both physically, spiritually, and emotionally. The disciples would see the countenance of Jesus change. His face shined like the sun. His clothes were whiter than white. And the glory of God was manifest. The disciples saw the glory of God that was inside Jesus radiating outside. Now, this transfiguration, there are two other times that we're introduced to this concept of transfiguration. If you hold it Mark 9 and go to Romans 12 and verse 2, Paul uses this same word, the same concept, transfiguration. He says, do not be conformed to this present world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may test and approve what is the will of God, what is good and well-pleasing and perfect. We transform so that what people see on the outside of us is what's on the inside of us. Another text that uses this word transfiguration or transform, this metamorphosis, is 2 Corinthians 3:18. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18. And we all, with unveiled faces, reflecting the glory of the Lord, are being what? Changed or transformed or metamorphosed in the same image from one degree of glory to another, which is from the Lord, who is the Spirit. The Christian life is a process by which the glory of God works within inside of us, transforming us into the character of Jesus Christ. Aren't you glad that God is doing that inside of us?
Amen.
Now, verse 4, Mark says, Elijah appeared before them along with Moses, and they were talking to Jesus. What do you think the significance of Elijah and Moses appearing before Jesus was? Why do you think that happened? And what do you think they talked about? Wouldn't you have loved to be on that conversation? And why was it important for Jesus to have that conversation with Moses and Elijah?
What did encourage him?
To encourage him, you're right. Jesus was headed to the cross. And he's the creator of the universe, but at this moment he was very lonely, very discouraged. He knew what was ahead. He knew that his life would be sacrificed. And he knew that he had these disciples that he had been teaching over 3 years. And he knew they still did not understand his mission. So God sent Moses and Elijah. And why did God pick these two men? Of all the saints that he could have picked, why did he pick these two men? And I hope you say, partly because the rest of them are in the grave, so they couldn't send them. But why these two men?
Moses is burned, and so he will be resurrected.
Yes, Moses represents those who will be resurrected.
Elijah represents those who are transformed.
And those who will be transformed. So it encompasses all of humanity. No one is left out. So here you have these three disciples, these three men who witnessed the transfiguration. Now, there are other significance about these men and others. For instance, there were three women who went to the tomb of Jesus and told the disciples about the resurrection. These three disciples are mentioned prominently throughout the Gospels. They're the first to receive the call. Their names usually show up first in the list of the disciples. It was these three men that Jesus chose to go to Jairus' house to resurrect his daughter. Peter was the first to confess that Jesus Christ was the Son of the living God. And James and John, they were the first to exploit Jesus. Probably would like to forget that, wouldn't they? And it's during the dark hours of Gethsemane that Jesus asked Peter, James, and John to pray with him. And did they pray with him? Yes. They also slept. But they did pray sometime. These three men witnessed Jesus' greatest moments of distress and his greatest moments of glory. Now, in verse 2, Mark is connecting what happened in the previous chapter to what is about to happen in the Transfiguration. When he says 6 days later, it's 6 days after Peter said, when Jesus said, "Whom do you say that I am?" And Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then Mark says, 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John and led them alone up to the high mountain privately, and he was transfigured before them. These three men climbed that mountain. Now, we're not told which mountain it is, but they climbed that mountain with Jesus. And it's interesting that Jesus often looks for times to get away, to spend time with God. And if Jesus needed to spend time with the Father, don't we need to spend time with him? Every Christian needs a place to be alone with God. And I hope you have that place where you can be alone with God. Now, 2 Peter chapter 1. Peter talks about this mountaintop experience. Chapter 1, verse 28. He said, "When the voice was conveyed from heaven, we ourselves heard it, for we were with him on," what does he call it? "The holy mountain." Peter is describing this transfiguration experience, this mountaintop experience. He called it the holy mountain. That high mountain became a holy mountain because he met Jesus in a new and more powerful way than he had ever experienced him. Verse 2 says, "And he was transfigured." Now, the challenge from Mark is, he wasn't there. How do you describe the transfiguration? How do you describe this most powerful moment that you didn't witness? How do you describe it? Pardon? In the word? Well, there are no words. I agree, there are no words. Let me illustrate the challenge. Napoleon was invading Russia, and somehow he got separated from his private guards. And some Russian soldiers spotted him, and they took chase. for several minutes, there was this frantic event going on of these soldiers chasing Napoleon. And Napoleon ran into a shop, it was a furrier shop, and he begged the shopkeeper to hide him. And the furrier, quick-minded, said, crawl under the furs, which he did, and then he added more furs on top of it. By the time that was done, those Russian soldiers burst into his shop, demanding to know where Napoleon was. The shopkeeper said, I don't know who you're talking about. And so they ransacked his shop. They even took their swords and pushed them into the furs. They left, not finding Napoleon. And as time passed, Napoleon finally crawled out from under the blankets, or under the furs. His private guard finally showed up. And before he was about to leave, this shopkeeper said, sir, I know you're a very important man. But what was it like being under those furs and to know that that might be the last moment of your life? What was it like? Well, Napoleon was, he was offended. And he said, so he told his soldiers to blindfold the shopkeeper and execute. So they took him to the wall of his shop. He was already blindfolded. He could hear the soldiers line up. And he heard Napoleon say, take aim. Tears flowing out of his eyes. And suddenly the blindfold came off. And Napoleon was nose to nose to this man. He says, now you have an answer to your question. Now you know. How do you describe this event? How do you put it into human words unless you were there to experience it? We know that Peter has a large influence on the Gospel of Mark. And so in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 through 18, Peter gives us an insight to the transfiguration because he was there. In verse 16, he says, for we did not follow cleverly devised tales when we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. And it's important not to miss that. Jesus said, some of you will not die before you see my majesty. And Peter said, yes, we saw it. Verse 17, for when he received honor and glory from God the Father, such an utterance as this made to him by the majestic glory, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Verse 18, and we ourselves heard this utterance made from heaven when we were with him on that holy mountain. Peter is acknowledging his mountaintop experience. He saw the majesty of Jesus that is described throughout the New Testament as the second coming of Christ. He was given a glimpse. He, James and John, were given a glimpse of the second coming of Christ in the Transfiguration. And we will get the privilege of seeing that when Jesus Christ comes in the clouds of glory. So how does the Transfiguration apply to you and I in 2018? What does it mean for us? It was a glorious experience for Peter, James, and John. But what does it mean for us? Well, let me put it this way. How do you describe your walk with Jesus Christ if you're not walking with him? How do you describe that peace that passes all understanding when you're going through your fiercest trials unless you're walking with Jesus every day? Let me illustrate it this way. In the winter of 320 AD, Emperor Licinius, he was the emperor of the eastern part of Rome. Constantine was the emperor of the west side of Rome. And he ordered that all Roman soldiers must renounce Christianity and pay homage to the Emperor of Rome. Because he could not stand Christianity. He was a major persecutor of Christians. And this edict was sent down all the way down to the legionaries. The story is told of 40 soldiers who were committed Christians, who withstood beatings, threats, and torture, and refused to bow down to the altar of the Caesar, and refused to pay homage to him. They worshipped only Jesus Christ. So in retaliation, they were taken to a frozen pond, required to remove all their armor, all their clothing, until they stood naked, and were forced to endure the torturous death of freezing. And they began to sing this song, "O Lord, 40 wrestlers have come forth to fight for you. Grant that 40 wrestlers may gain the victory." Now the mother of the youngest legionnaire convinced her son to come back because they had created a big fire, lots of food. Their song changed to, "O Lord, 39 soldiers wrestle, give us the victory." Well, the centurion who was in charge, Centurion Sempronius, acknowledged Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior for the first time, publicly acknowledged it. Went on that frozen pond, removed his armor, his weapons, his clothing. And again, they sang, 40. We can only describe what it is to have an intimate relationship with Jesus Christ by having that intimate relationship. In Mark 9, verse 3, describing the clothing of Jesus, where it says, his clothing began to radiate white, more so than a laundry shop could do. So it was whiter than white. In fact, the Greek word there means to cast rays of light, to shine, or to gleam. It's amazing. For a few moments, the humanity of Jesus was outshined by the glory of his godliness, of his divinity. Verses 5 and 6 of Mark. So Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Now Mark will tell us in the next verse that these men were terrified. Right? The Greek word that's used there, ekphobias, is a rare and intense. They were terrified. You hear that expression, they were scared out of their skins? They were terrified beyond the word they were terrified to describe. Do you remember the last time that you were so scared you were terrified? Mark 9, 7 and 8. "Then the cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came from the cloud, 'This is my dear son.'" What does he say to them? "Listen." Now the mistake that Peter made when he said, "Rabbi, shall we build these shelters?" wasn't that he was not acknowledging the Messiah of Jesus. It wasn't because he wanted to stay longer. It was rather that he did not recognize the uniqueness of Jesus Christ. He did not recognize the superiority of Jesus Christ over Moses and Elijah. He saw them as co-equals. You ever heard of the 2x4 approach? God had to use a 2x4. And he spoke from heaven and said, he didn't say Peter, James, and John, but what he was saying to them is, "This is my beloved son. Get the message." They did not understand the mission of Jesus Christ. They didn't understand what was going to happen. And they were going to be the leaders of the church. They were going to be the movement that would turn the world upside downwards. And they were still confused. And verse 8 says, suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore except Jesus. Their father's referring to Jesus as my beloved son. And the reason he's doing this is because he knows for the next 2 months that he's headed to the cross. And he knows that the culture in which the apostles live in is that if bad things happen to you, it's because you're cursed of God. And if good things happen to you, it's because, well, you've been living a good life. And he did not want the disciples to be confused that Jesus was being punished by God, but rather that he was being faithful to God. And as Mark is recording this experience, he is telling this so that the readers, the Christians of Rome, who are under intense persecution, will know that they're not being persecuted because they're bad. They're suffering because they are the followers of Jesus Christ. And because God loved him, he also loved them. And gave them the courage they needed to be faithful. Verses 9 and 10, it says, and they were coming down from the mountain. He gave them the orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until after the Son of Man had been risen from the dead. And they kept the statements to themselves, discussing what this rising from the dead meant. After 3 years, they still haven't figured it out. And they began the discussion, what did Jesus mean when he said, the Son of Man rise from the dead? Now, they knew that Jesus had raised a girl from the dead. And they knew that he had raised another man from the dead, and they would know that he would raise Lazarus from the dead. And they began to wonder, who is going to raise Jesus from the dead? And then they began to plan with themselves, as maybe we can keep Jesus from dying. There's no doubt these three disciples witnessed an amazing miracle. They encountered Jesus Christ in his unveiled glory, speaking to Moses and to Elijah. Unfortunately, their focus was more on Moses and Elijah than it was on Jesus. They had trouble comprehending his words when he talked about suffering. When he talked about dying, when he talked about the resurrection. They walked with the Lord, but often lost focus and had difficulty understanding. My friends, we are living in the end times. And we need to maintain that close walk with Jesus. We need to spend time with his word. We need to spend time in prayer. Because the Lord will provide us the wisdom that we need to be faithful disciples. As James said in James 1:5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God and give it to all men liberally, and it shall be given him. To win our battle against Satan, we need to surrender to Jesus Christ. We need to invite the Holy Spirit into our hearts and our minds, so that we can let go of our selfishness and be filled with the power of his Spirit. That's the kind of faith that leads to total dependence upon God. Our faith will be stronger as we spend more and more time with Jesus. And whatever barriers, whatever arrows the devil throws at us, because we're with Jesus, we know he is helpless. We know he is defeated. No matter what trials he throws at us, no matter what difficulties he throws at us, no matter what hardships come our way, when we have that daily walk with Jesus, he empowers us to be victorious over everything the devil throws at us. And just as we can't describe a simple garden You can't describe what it is to have peace with Jesus unless we have peace with Jesus. So I encourage you this week, spend time with the Lord in prayer. Spend time with the Lord in Bible study. Either by yourself or with others. Spend time with Him. Let's pray.